دع الأيام تفعل ما تشاء وطب نفسا إذا حكم القضاء ولا تجزع لحادثة الليالي فما لحوادث الدنيا بقاء وكن رجلا على
الحمد لله. All praise is due to Allah, the One and the Unique. It is He alone that we worship, and it is His blessings that we seek. He is the Lord of the oppressed, and He answers the call of the weak. Dear Muslims, one of the matters that many of us have noticed, and it is one of the signs of the Day of Judgment, is the frequent news that we receive of the death of our ulama and our senior, respectable people of this ummah, especially during this last year. And especially during this COVID crisis, it is as if we are seeing them one by one go. And this last week as well, multiple deaths occurred in the global Muslim community of ulama that were respected across the world. And in the English-speaking world as well, multiple scholars have been taken away from us in the last few weeks and months, and especially in the last year. And this is something that is causing distress to everybody who understands the implications of this. Because, dear Muslims, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the scholars are the inheritors of the prophets. Collectively, the ulama take on the role of the prophets. Collectively, there is no prophet amongst us. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has left back to his Lord. But collectively, the ulama step up partially and they guide the ummah and they instruct the ummah and they inspire the ummah, and they are the ones through them Allah teaches the Quran and Sunnah through the ulama. When the ulama are taken away, what will be left? And that is why it is a very terrifying sign, dear Muslims. And I remind myself and all of you to take advantage of our ulama, to associate with them, to learn from them before they are taken away. It is so true that a person and an ummah does not recognize the status of its ulama until they are taken away and it is too late. So appreciate the ilm that exists in all civilizations and cultures and languages. In every language that you speak, you will find people of knowledge. Appreciate them, make dua for them, benefit from them. And in particular, dear Muslims, try your best to associate. As one of the great scholars of the past said, I love knowledge even though I am not a scholar. So I hope Allah raises me with the people of knowledge even though I don't deserve that title. So be with ilm, because ilm inspires you. Ilm is the foundation that allows us to be where we are. And in particular, dear Muslims, I wanted to mention the story of one person. He is not even an alim in the technical sense, and yet it is something that I find very inspiring to mention his story. And it is somebody who, I will not claim he is a teacher of mine, he's not a teacher, but I had the opportunity to interact with him a few times. And he just passed away, and he was buried yesterday in Baqi' al-Gharqad in Medina. Janazah was after Salat al-Fajr, and he was buried in Baqi' in Medina. And it is a name that most of you are aware of, Dr. Muhammad Muhsin Khan. He passed away at the age of 97, after living a century amongst us. And his story is very inspiring because it gives hope to those who are not even ulama. You don't have to have ilm to benefit the ummah. You don't have to have traveled and studied ilm just to benefit the ummah. You can benefit the ummah no matter what your field is. Dr. Muhammad Muhsin Khan, he is the person who first translated Sahih al-Bukhari into the English language. And he translated the Quran and other books into the English language when no such translation existed. But his story is very interesting, and Allah bless me to interact with him and hear this story personally from him more than one time when I was a student in the blessed city of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Dr. Muhsin Khan was born in an Afghan family in pre-partition India, and born in the 1920s. And he was of the first batches to study abroad, overseas, in the West. He studied in England, and he got his MBBS, which is his degree in medicine. And then he pursued a specialty of heart and chest diseases. This is in the 1950s, when hardly any Muslim was living in the West, much less studying in the West. So he became top-notch in his field. And then an offer came to him from King Abdul Aziz of Saudi Arabia to come and be in charge of the specialty unit of heart and chest diseases in the military hospital. It's a very prestigious, very well-paying He said this to me directly. He said, I was not a religious person and I did not choose the job to go to Saudi Arabia, to go to Mecca and Medina. I chose the job because it paid well. He said this to me directly. I chose the job because it paid well. I left England and I went to the city of Al-Ta'if, which was where the military hospital was. This is in the late 50s. And he stayed there and he established his credentials. Then in 1961, the Islamic University of Medina, where I studied for 10 years, it opened up. In 1961, they needed a hospital for the students and faculty and staff, and I have visited that hospital a few times. So they needed a doctor. But it's 1961, and back then there are no qualified Muslim doctors. You have to be a Muslim to live in Medina. So by royal decree, not that he wanted it, Dr. Muhsin Khan was transferred to become the chief doctor for the University of Medina, as a doctor, not as an alim, not as a sheikh. And he entered Medina as a doctor because of the salary. How many amongst us would love to live there because of the religion? And he told me this directly. I went there because of the job and because the king forced me. I didn't want to go to Medina because he had a good position in Ta'if, but he went to Medina. And he said, within a few weeks, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a dream. And it's a very long dream, and at the one portion of the dream, the Prophet was sweating. And he, Dr. Muhsin Khan, he took that sweat and he drank it. He woke up and he was shocked. What does this dream mean? He went to the rector of the university, his Sheikh bin Baz, a famous, the Grand Mufti at the time. This is 1960 something. He went to Sheikh bin Baz and he said, Sheikh, you know, I'm the doctor of your hospital. I saw this dream. What does it mean? The Sheikh said to him, this means you are going to benefit the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Dr. Muhsin told us, I was shocked. I am a medical doctor. I'm not a sheikh, an alim. I don't know anything about Islam. I'm not even that religious back in that day, but Allah had plans for him. Allah had plans for him that even he did not know. He was shocked. He goes, what can I do that can benefit the sunnah? So he said, I began asking around because he knew that this is a dream. He asked to do something. And he discovered, this is 1960 something, that these famous and important books had not been translated. Nobody spoke fluent Arabic and fluent English at the time. And he realized that he spoke fluent English because he's trained in England for so many years. He spoke fluent English. So he said, the idea then came to me that perhaps Allah Azza wa Jalla is showing me to translate these books for the Ummah. But he didn't have any ilm. So he went to Sheikh bin Baz. Sheikh bin Baz assigned him another great scholar, Dr. Taqiyuddin al-Hilali. He was a Moroccan scholar who back in the 1930s went to Germany when Nazis were ruling it. And he did his PhD in Islamic studies. So he spoke French and German and English and Arabic, a multilingual scholar. So he was assigned Dr. Taqiyuddin and Dr. Muhsin Khan, the two of them, in the 1960s when there was no authentic translation of the Quran done by Muslims. Back then it was done by non-Muslims. And no book of hadith had been translated by this point in time. And the two of them sat together, he gave up his job, and they translated, mashallah, tabarakallah, the entirety of Sahih Bukhari and a commentary of the Quran. One of them is multi-volume and the other one is one volume. Now it is true to say, when we look back at it, we can find errors and methodological problems, but subhanallah, hindsight is 20/20. Rather than picking and nitpicking their errors, we should look at them as paving the way for the rest of us, opening the doors for the rest of us. Yes, it's not a perfect translation. But the point is, they raised the bar when there was no bar. And they allowed later people like us to come and say, okay, this is incorrect, we can make it better. So we can build from what they left us. Now, why am I telling you this story? Because for me, it's such an inspiring story that you can benefit the Ummah in a global scale. I am positive that 95% of you know Dr. Muhsin Khan, but you don't know his story. You have his translation at home, but you don't know anything about him. Do you know he's not a sheikh? He's not an alim. He didn't study full-time Islamic studies. He himself was shocked. How can I help the Ummah? But Allah Azza wa Jal had a plan for him. So with ikhlas, under the guidance of ilm, of ulama, and with sincerity, and with humility and humbleness, and wallahi, I met him a number of times, you would not even think that this is a medical doctor from England with prestigious degrees and money. You would not even know this. Such a humble and simple person. He would be lost in the crowd. You would not know him if you didn't know who he was. And yet what he did literally impacted the English-speaking world in its entirety. What is the takeaway message, dear Muslims? Very simple. You too can benefit the Ummah in your own way. Don't let barriers that you put in your head, like he himself said, I haven't studied ilm. Okay, but I have something else I can do. I have another talent that Allah has given me. Every one of you sitting here, without a question, without a doubt, you have something to contribute that is unique to you. No one other than you can do what you can do. So think, what can I do? And then do it. And Allah will open up doors. And how do you know? What do you know? Maybe the door that opens up in front of you will be a door that will benefit the entirety of the ummah and will leave a sadaqah jariyah, the likes of which you cannot even imagine. Where did he begin his journey? Where was he in the middle in England? And where did he end up being buried? In Medina, in the qabr of Baqi' al-Gharqad, after living 50 years in the blessed holy city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He did not attend it, but Allah intended it. And when Allah intends good for somebody, all of these doors open up. So dear Muslims, ask yourself, what is your talent? What can you do for the ummah? How can you benefit? Maybe it is in mentoring some young children. Maybe it is in teaching Sunday school. Maybe it is being operating in a charity, doing something that you have a passion and a skill that nobody else does. And through that, Allah Azza wa Jal might change people's hearts and bring sadaqah jariyah that will benefit you, not just till the day you die, but more importantly, after you are gone, and that sadaqah jariyah remains. So here is my challenge to you and to me. And the question is, what can I do to benefit the ummah? That's the question that should be on your mind morning and evening, and then work to do that. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for tawfiq and ikhlas. Allahumma inni da'in fa amminu. Oh Allah, we ask that you not leave any sin of ours here except that you have overlooked them, and any sick amongst us except that you have healed them, and any diseased amongst us except that you have forgiven them, and any misguided amongst us except that you have guided them, and any debt of ours except that you have repaid them, and any problem of ours except that you have blessed us and allowed us to overcome them. Ya Rahmanu, Ya Rahim. Oh Allah, we ask that you lift from us this plague and this disease, and that you bless us with a life of comfort and ease. Oh Allah, of this dunya we ask you the best, and on judgment day we ask that we pass the test, and of the akhirah that you make us amongst the blessed, for you are the Rahman and the Rahim. Oh Allah, bless the ummah and its people, and oh Allah, make it safe and peaceful, and protect it against those who desire for it evil with your strength, Ya Qawiyu, Ya Aziz. O people, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded you with a command that he began with himself, and then he seconded it with the angels themselves, and then he asked you to follow it with your own actions. For he said, عَزَّ مِنْ قَالٍ عَلِيمًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَةُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارك وأنعم على عبدك ورسولك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. عباد الله, إن الله تعالى يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه يزد لكم ولذكر الله تعالى أكبر وأقم الصلاة.
يا من أجبت دعاء نوح فانتصر وحملته في فلكك المشحون, يا من أحال النار حول خليله روحا وريحانا بقولك كون.